So I'm here with local journalist Ellie Evans for this episode of The Vote. We're going to be talking about the Labour leadership campaign, both the actual leadership and the deputy leadership. So Ellie, give us an update because it's been going on a while, hasn't it? So where are we at the moment?
It's been going on a while and it's going to be going on a while longer. So we've got whittled down to three candidates for the leadership contest: Keir Starmer, Rebecca Long-Bailey and Lisa Nandy. Some results came out just very recently from a poll with YouGov and Sky News in which Keir Starmer is leading by about more than 50%, about 52%, I think. Rebecca Long-Bailey's on about 30% and Lisa Nandy is on 16%. So that's the way it's looking at the moment. He's potentially streets ahead the winner, but as we've seen from politics in recent years, who knows what's going to happen.
What about Lisa Nandy? Because she's done very well, hasn't she? But did she ever stand a chance?
For me, I think she's a really, really strong candidate and she has played to her strengths. She's also, it's important to bear in mind that she's the most experienced of all the three candidates. She's been a politician for 10 years, an MP for 10 years, whereas they've only been an MP for the last 5 or 6 years. And so and she's got more front bench experience. And so in a way, she could be considered to be the safest pair of hands out of the three of them. She's considered more soft left than the other two might be. I still think she's got a great chance, but, you know, as I said, anything happens at this point.
And the favourite was Rebecca Long-Bailey, because she was almost kind of groomed in a way, like, to be the next the replacement for Jeremy Corbyn. But is that not working out as expected? Because we don't know enough about Rebecca Long-Bailey, do we? That's been a bit of a problem.
I think what you're saying there works. So she's being seen as continuity Corbyn, which is working in her favour. She's got the backing of the entire Momentum party, Momentum wing of the party, which is around 70,000 people. But at the same time, she's being seen as continuity Corbyn, which is also working against her. So I think she's running a strong race. She's been very forthright. There was a really interesting poll that was done in January in which the members of the party were asked to rank the candidates according to their characteristics and which traits they thought was most important. And she came out top on likability and also on having strong political convictions. And members said that that was actually the trait which was most important to them. So again, she's got, 33% chance at the moment or whatever it is. I really think that could change because she seems to have a big groundswell of support behind her.
But we still think Keir Starmer's going to make it as leader. Is he going to be the leader that takes him into the next election then, which is probably going to be, nearly 5 years' time, do you think? It's going to be Keir Starmer?
He is a safe pair of hands. We've said that from the beginning.
Yeah.
I think also importantly, another poll that was done earlier this month showed that he was being seen as the best potential prime minister. So when people were asked, non-Labour supporters were asked who they would vote for, whether they would vote for Labour if this particular person was the leader, Keir Starmer gained around 20% of the vote. So 20% of people said that if Keir Starmer was leader, they would vote Labour. So that's a big deal for Labour.
Yeah.
I mean, there wasn't a huge amount in it. Rebecca Long-Bailey scored the lowest on that and she got 12%. So there wasn't a huge amount in it. But your average Labour person could say, right, he's the person that could genuinely get us back in.
Because we might still not see a first female leader of the Labour Party, which would be quite disappointing. I mean, the Tories have had two.
Mm.
Margaret Thatcher and Theresa May. So we've had two female prime ministers, which have come from the Conservatives. We've had Jo Swinson, Liberal Democrat female leader. But do you think we're going to have to wait a bit longer for the first female Labour leader, do you think?
Nicola Sturgeon.
Nicola Sturgeon as well. Must have forget her, Scottish National Party, yeah.
Yes, and we've said this to each other before. I really was really hoping that we would see a female leader this time
around.
It seems quite shocking that one of our most progressive parties hasn't had a woman lead it. It still might change, but it does seem to me that potentially, Lisa Nandy's also said this, that there is a sort of an element of misogyny behind this. She is the most experienced candidate, yet she was told by some members of the Parliamentary Labour Party that she maybe, it wasn't her time to throw her hat in the ring because she didn't quite have the experience, yet they went and then also put forward a man who had half of the experience that she did, and she has called that out as misogyny. Keir Starmer is polling well with men and women, so it's not as if it's just men voting for a man. I'd really hesitate to say that. He's doing well across the board. Yeah. It just seems maybe that we're not as progressive a place as we could be, in which people are seeing that a woman and a younger, vibrant, passionate woman can be leading a major political party.
Yeah, she also says former director of public prosecution, so that gives him a kind of a... I mean, that's why I guess we could see him as an establishment figure. Mm. But that means he'll be able to really provide the Tories with a strong opposition, because we do need that at the moment, don't we, with that massive majority that the Tories have got. We need some kind of opposition, and we're not hearing anything from the Liberal Democrats, are we, at the moment? We're hearing a bit from the SNP, but they've got their own internal problems as well. So this is important, isn't it, this election? It might not seem important to many people, but it is going forward.
It's huge. It really is huge. And I think none of them are downplaying that in any of the stuff that I've seen or heard or read from any of them. I think they really do see that this is a chance to unite a party that's, you know, fragmented and splintered. I think one of the main challenges that he will face, if he is then eventual leader, is that how do you then reconcile the liberal values of Labour Party members with the increasing conservatism of those areas, those red wall constituencies, which they lost so spectacularly in the December election?
What's come up during the debates, and we've had a series of debates, both deputy, which we'll go into the second half about the deputy leadership, but what's come up in the leadership debates then? There's been some interesting issues that have come up, which might not be of relevance to the wider electorate or that important top of their agenda, but there's been a lot of kind of internal ideological discussions, hasn't there?
Definitely, and particularly around the trans rights issue. I think that issue was well handled during the debate, in which each of the three candidates refused to take up a really polarising position on this. And actually, all of them are saying, let's have a much more nuanced discussion about this. You know, and Keir Starmer was quite outright about that, about refusing to be put into a pigeonhole of yes or no, you know, quick, hard, you know, black and white answers on things. Whereas actually this is needs a much more nuanced discussion over a longer period of time than just, you know, quick fire answers during a debate. So we've had the trans rights issue.
Yeah.
We've had the Brexit issue, the B word. Again, with Keir Starmer being called to account a little bit for having been
pushing.
He's
saying get on with it now, isn't he?
Well, yeah, he's flip-flopped. Oh, no, sorry. Changed his mind. So we've had Brexit.
Yeah.
We've also had Jeremy Corbyn as a big talking point as well. You know, whether Rebecca Long-Bailey, to be fair to her, has refused to sell her mentor down the river, whereas Lisa Nandy, who resigned from the front bench in 2016 over his leadership, has been quite outspoken on that. So Jeremy Corbyn has been a shadow looming over this as well, and a big point of discussion.
Yeah, just before we finish up for the first half, Lisa Nandy seems to be the person that's most in tune with the need to have radical change within the internal structure of the Labour Party. Is that right? Has she been the one? Is she the most radical candidate out of the three leadership candidates, would you say, or not? That's the sense I get, but maybe...
In some ways, I would say she's one of the more measured candidates, because she's very... She's thoughtful and she seems to reflect a lot. Some people have accused her of flip-flopping and of changing her mind on things, but I would really rather have someone who contemplated ideas and then maybe was happy to assume a different position on them. I see her as actually being one of the more thoughtful and reflective of the candidates, whereas Rebecca Long-Bailey, I would say, is more unapologetically out there with some of her views.
Right, OK. And what about Rebecca Long-Bailey? Is she criticising the Corbyn kind of policies from the last election or not?
She's not. I mean, but she was integral in so many of those herself, and the creation of the manifesto and everything. So she's having to tread quite a fine line here, because she doesn't want to criticise her mentor, and she also needs to be thinking about uniting the party and bringing in that alienated... Yeah. more centrist side of it. So she's been walking a bit of a tightrope. But no, I think she's been quite open about where the manifesto went wrong. They all have. They've all, you know, been saying it was too much of a wish list, too much of a shopping list. I think Dawn Butler, one of the deputy leadership candidates, said it was like going to a carvery, you know, where you just pile everything on your plate at once. And so Rebecca Long Bailey's been really open about that. And they all have. They've all been just very transparent and open about where they've gone wrong, holding their hands up and saying, let's look to the future.
Yeah, all right. We'll leave it there for now. Join us for the second half. We're going to be talking about the timeline for the Labour leadership plus the deputy leadership as well. So join us shortly for the second half. So welcome back to The Vote. I'm here with Ellie Evans, local journalist. We're talking about Labour leadership. Should we just talk about the timeline, Ellie? Because we're looking at April, aren't we? I mean, it's been going on, you know, the Tories get it done quite, they're quite ruthless, aren't they, in their leadership elections? You get slung out, you know, unceremoniously, and then it's all very quite quick. And often, the Tory leadership, I've noticed, they don't have a membership vote either. I mean, Theresa May wasn't elected by the members, she was elected by members of Parliament. It's very different than the Labour Party. It's a long, drawn-out saga. Is that fair?
I think, as we said, it feels like it's already been going on for a while.
Yeah.
It's still got more than a month to go. So at the moment, it's open to members of the party and also registered supporters. So the vote's gone out to them. They have a chance. They rank their three candidates according to their preferences, 1, 2, 3, and then return. And the votes will be counted on the 2nd of April. And then the winner is announced at a special conference on the 4th of April.
So the 4th of April. And, of course, during this time, Jeremy Corbyn's still been doing Prime Minister's questions, which does feel a bit odd. Like, he's basically lost two elections and he's still doing Prime Minister's questions. Because he doesn't look too comfortable doing that either. But I think he's done it to sacrifice himself in a way to make sure there's a smooth process to make sure they get the right leader. Is that fair, do you think?
It's got to be a sense that he's phoning that in a bit, you know, isn't it? He's just got to hang on now for another 5 weeks or so and try not to do anything to make things much worse than they already have been since the December election.
So the ballots are out then already? Is that where we're at? So the ballots are out. We've got a big membership, haven't we? You were saying about how many voters have joined the Labour Party, what, since December? How many is it again? It's over 100,000?
Yeah, they've seen an increase of 114,000 members since December. So, and that's brought the total to more than 560,000 members of the Labour Party. I mean, to put that into perspective, when Ed Miliband was leading the party, they had about 180,000 in total. So it's been a significant surge in membership. Highly likely because many, many people now want to have their say and want to have the chance to shape the party by being involved in electing the leader.
OK, and this is working in Keir Starmer's favour, we think. I mean, I saw that there's some polling that Channel 4 News did and a lot of the new voters, they're more likely to vote Keir Starmer. I remember that, even in the London heartlands, Labour heartland. So this new membership's basically worked in his favour, is that right?
That wouldn't surprise me, right. and particularly as the fact that we've seen that Keir Starmer is well ahead in the polls. You know, he's at 52%, whereas the others are at 30% and 16%. Yeah. So that really wouldn't surprise me. Let's not forget that Rebecca Long Bailey, she has the backing of Momentum, but
is that a good thing?
Well, again, that remains to be seen. But and also the way that Momentum did it was criticised as well because they didn't actually give their members the option. Well, the only option that they gave was, would you like to back Rebecca Long Bailey, yes or no? They weren't given the choice of the other candidates. So 50% of members said yes, but you may then have potentially 50% of members who are quite disgruntled and would otherwise have backed one of the others.
So much for democracy then. So talk about the deputy leadership. We haven't heard that much about Labour the actual leadership, but deputy leadership, I mean, it's very little media coverage that's been given. So who are the main kind of...
So we've got Angela Rayner. Angela Rayner is hot fave to win this. And together with Keir Starmer, if Keir Starmer is also a winner, this could be a really good balance. Angela Rayner is... tight buddies with Rebecca Long Bailey. She's a firebrand. She describes herself as being bombastic. She was a single mum at 16, yeah. a teenage mum at 16, you know, mother of three, a grandmother now as well. And she's probably, I think she's nearly 40. You know, but she's very outspoken and she's very relatable. And that's something that could really stand them in good stead. Because one thing you could say about Keir Starmer is he's not especially relatable. He's a QC. He's, you know, part of the London elite. Whereas Angela Rayner, strong Manchester accent, you know, really out there.
Authentic.
And really authentic, yeah. exactly. And yeah. really likable as a result. So she's had quite a quiet campaign, but then came out this week with a really strong interview on ITV, which has caused a lot of headlines. She, one of the reasons why it did cause headlines was because she was outspoken about Jeremy Corbyn and saying that he didn't command respect. So, unlike Rebecca Long Bailey, her friend, she's, you know, quite happy to say where they've gone wrong, where Jeremy Corbyn has led them wrongly, yeah. and how she'd like to rectify that. So we've got Angela Rayner leading a really strong campaign. Another strong potential contender there is Ian Murray. Whether or not it's going to work in his favour, Tony Blair.
He's the only Labour MP in Scotland, isn't he, Ian
Murray?
He's
the only,
for
yes.
Edinburgh South, I think, so...
Yes.
I mean, maybe they need him if he's the only Scottish representative, because they're going to need to win back some Scottish seats. So, what's Tony Blair saying about Ian? Sorry.
Sorry, so potentially a good strategic move for them, definitely. So, Tony Blair and Gordon Brown have both come out backing Ian Murray, so... Bear in mind that Tony Blair has refused to endorse any of the three leadership candidates because he called it the kiss of death, or potentially saw that it would be the kiss of death. So who knows what this then means for Ian Murray. But, you know, that's potentially in his favour.
Yeah.
Dawn Butler is amongst the people that I have spoken to. She's really popular, but she gave quite an outspoken interview recently. Yeah. She's tired, you know. She's saying it's really hard, and it's really hard to finance the campaign. You know, which not many of the other candidates
she's
have been
got
open
high, about. She's got a fairly high media profile, Dawn Butler, because she's, I know she's on, you know, the Radio 4 Today programme a lot. She's much more, we know Dawn Butler, don't we? Mm. We know Angela Rayner a bit. We don't know so much Ian Murray. So I'm thinking Dawn Butler's quite a good move for the Labour leadership as well, deputy leadership.
Particularly bearing in mind that we're in an era now of personality politics more than anything else, and it is going to be that, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's going to be the face and the name that resonates more than the policies and more than the political convictions sometimes.
Yeah. Anyone else in there? So we've got Ian Murray, Dawn Butler, Angela Rayner. There's other candidates as well.
There's two others. There's Richard
Bergen.
Yeah. Richard Bergen, who has actually probably fought one of the most high-profile campaigns that I've seen. Certainly, you know, he's been popping up in my newsfeed a lot. And then another Central London candidate, whose name completely escapes me at this point. I'm really sorry.
But there are two other candidates there, aren't they? So, and Richard Bergen, he was I think the shadow minister for the City of London previously. So he's got a kind of financial background there, but he is quite left-wing, isn't he, Richard Bergen?
Definitely.
He's quite famous for that.
Yes, he is. And again, you know, strong opinions, pitching himself as a firebrand, you know, and unafraid to put himself out there, which, again, tempered with a more moderate, potentially moderate leader like Keir Starmer, seen as a safe pair of hands, you could then have a much more strong and fiery deputy to...
See then, so we had... Tony Blair has come out and he said we need radical reform. Mm. You know, he's put it quite in stark terms. We've had Jonathan Powell saying that, you know, the Tories, they've reinvented themselves. As he puts it, they've kind of gone towards English nationalism and kind of reinvented themselves as a party of the North. The Tories seem to do that quite a lot. They're quite ruthless, aren't they? Because the Tories really about getting into power, aren't they? We've spoken about this before. Who's the best person to get into power? So...
Absolutely, and it comes back to that same point of trying to marry up the more liberal side of the party with this conservatism from the Leave voting red wall, and actually, you know, this is why reindustrialisation has figured really highly on some of the candidates' priorities, particularly Rebecca Long Bailey, is always talking about reindustrialisation of the North.
Yeah.
Lisa Nandy has said that if she becomes leader, she would actually move the Labour Party headquarters to Warrington out of London.
Yeah.
And, you know, Keir Starmer's talking a lot about devolving more powers to local authorities.
Yeah.
So I think this is something that they're all thinking about, how to match this levelling up idea that the Conservatives are putting forward. In terms of being ruthless, you know, at the moment, this stage, this campaign is more about a sort of wish list of things, isn't it? And everything then remains to be seen. But I think, you know, you're seeing some very strong convictions and some very clear-cut ideas from these three that have made it through this far.
Yeah. I mean, what about issues like anti-Semitism out of the party? Do you see the other candidates doing that?
I agree with you about Keir Starmer. I mean, this is a man who has spent his life fighting injustice.
And prosecuting.
Exactly, you know, with a background in human rights. And, you know, this is clearly something that he is going to take seriously and act upon. But then, you know, Lisa Nandy has got the backing of some very influential Jewish community groups.
Yeah.
And she's been actually out there, you know, canvassing and meeting people from the Jewish community. And this is something that she's really vocal on, whilst also leading the... one of the committees for Palestine. So she's really showing that you don't have to be... this opinion of anti-Semitism to do with opposing Palestine... Yeah. I'm sorry, with backing Palestine. She's saying, you know, it doesn't need to be an either-or situation, and she's really working well to straddle both camps.
All right, well, we'll leave it there for now then. So we've got the timeline going forward. We're basically going to know who it is on the 4th of April. And we'll speak to you again, Ellie, when we get the new Labour leader, to see how they're going to transform the Labour Party. So thanks for coming again today, and we'll catch up again soon. Thanks.